السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. We continue with our tafsir of Surah An-Nahl. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues in verse number 79. أَلَمْ يَرَوْا إِلَى الطَّيْرِ مُسَخَّرَاتٍ فِي جَوِّ السَّمَاءِ مَا يُمْسِكُهُنَّ إِلَّا اللَّهِ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. SubhanAllah, I love this verse. Allah says, don't they look above at the birds? أَلَمْ يَرَوْا إِلَى الطَّيْرِ مُسَخَّرَاتٍ. مُسَخَّرَاتٍ from the word تَسْخِيرٍ. It means to force something in its place. So as a result, these birds stay up in the sky and they're on their own flight path doing whatever they need to do. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by His will, allows them to continue their path in the air. Now, you know, years ago, before 9/11, before all of that stuff, you were allowed to knock on the door and talk to some of the pilots, right? And I did this years ago. I think it was like in early 2000 or something. And I was flying with Saudi Airlines. I was going from the city of Jeddah to Medina. And the cockpit area, the pilots were there and their door was open, so you could see them pressing all the buttons and, you know, they're about to take off and getting themselves ready. So I remember standing by the door and I asked before we began, before they started to start the plane and before we were going to head out to the runway, I remember asking one of the pilots, how does this plane come off the ground? So he looks at me and he says, do you want the technical answer or do you want just the truth? So I said both. So he gives me the technical answer and he starts describing to me the wings and the shape of the wings and airflow and lift, and he starts explaining all of these things to me. So I'm like, okay, that seems to make sense. So what's the truth? And he looks at me and he says, I don't know, only Allah knows. And I thought to myself, I don't think I would have ever forgotten that conversation. The pilot is literally saying to me, only Allah knows how this thing comes off the ground. When you look at birds, now keep in mind the previous ayah, Allah talked to us about hearing, about seeing, and about the heart. Wa afida, and about the heart. So let's just say, you know, hearing, that's out of the question, okay? Clearly, the audience in this ayah, in verse number 79, are not listening. So fine, forget about the heart. At least you use your eyes. So the lesson here for all of us at the very get-go is, if you have a problem listening, if you have a problem taking knowledge, if you have a problem listening to advice, guidance, etc., at least use your eyes. And if you're somebody that's a great listener, but you internalize hardly nothing for whatever reason, at least use your eyes. Look up into the sky and look at a bird. And that bird, the fact that it can get off the ground and be hundreds of feet in the air, that in and of itself, Allah is saying, is musakharat. Allah forces and pins the bird in the air to be able to do that. في جو السماء ما يمسكهن إلا الله. Nothing holds this bird in the sky and it's suspended there except Allah. In Surah Al-Mulk it says, إلا الرحمن, except the merciful one. Why? Because the fact that this bird can come off the ground, get into the sky and go to its destination in and of itself is also by Allah's permission, but also a reflection of Allah's mercy. Allah has mercy on the bird to allow it to do that. How do you and I now internalize that lesson? When you're on a plane, that's one of the verses that I never forget. Whenever I'm flying somewhere, first thing that comes to mind when I'm on that plane, مَا يُمْسِكُهُنَّ إِلَّا الرَّحْمَنِ. Nothing will hold this plane together and keep it in the sky except الرَّحْمَنِ. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ. Now listen to how this verse ends. It's remarkable. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. Indeed, these are ayat and miracles. Now listen to the word ayat. Allah didn't say ayah. He uses the plural form, ayat. There are many miracles of just watching birds in the sky. But the only way you're going to appreciate those miracles, the only way a bird is going to look more than just a bird, is your iman is going to talk. Your iman steps in. Your iman is reflecting. Your iman is allowing you to think, is allowing you to appreciate. When you look up into the sky and you see these birds, your iman kicks in and you say, SubhanAllah, look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows these birds to be in the sky. You know, years ago when they were designing the Airbus 380, which was the largest or is the largest passenger airplane in the world. One issue that they ran into is when they designed the wings, when they did the test flights, they realized that there was a lot of vibration, a lot of instability because of the way airflow was happening. The wings were too massive, their structure was so broad and wide that airflow was just a challenge for them. And you won't believe, I watched a documentary on this, you won't believe how they solved this problem. If you notice that the Airbus 380, at the tip of the wings, there's a slight extension that goes up like this. So you have the wing, and then you have a slight extension that goes up like this, and that's how the plane is flying. So the wings are going across the air and cutting the air this way. So this little extension, this little tip they added at the very edge, you can look at any Airbus 380, Google it, and just look at the tip of the wings. You'll always see like there's this extra piece that's been added at the edge of those wings. That's how they were able to break the cycle of wind that was causing the vibration so that they could create a smooth airflow. They added this piece. Now, here's the point. Guess how they figured this out? They sent out a bunch of scientists into the fields to look at how birds, the biggest birds in the world with the largest wingspan. So, what bird is that? It's the eagles. So, they went out looking at eagles and studied how eagles land, and they would record hundreds of them, and they would study their wings and the shape of their wings and how their wings would adjust to the air as they were landing. And they noticed that the eagle, which has the largest wingspan on the planet, they noticed that at the edge of that eagle's wing, it would protrude, it would elevate slightly, and that's how the eagle would maintain a smooth flight in the air as well as landing. So they decided to copy the same pattern onto the biggest passenger airplane ever built, and it solved the problem. Subhanallah. Mankind learned how to build and design planes from the creatures that you and I see every single day. They land in front of our house, they eat, from our grass, they're just, they're everywhere. Pigeons, birds, seagulls, what have you. And some of the greatest inventions and structures ever created by mankind was designed and replicated after these creatures. That's the ayat that you want to appreciate and reflect on when you're looking at birds. وَاللَّهُ جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّن بُيُوتِكُمْ سَكَنًا. Allah also created for you homes where you can find peace and tranquility in them. Do you notice that? You know, people say, well, it's my house. Of course, I'm going to find peace there. Of course, when I'm at work or outside or anywhere else, it's nothing like home. There's no place like home, as the old saying goes. Well, guess what? There's no place like home. That saying, that feeling, that connection that we have to our homes, Allah says that's from Him. He gives you that sakina. He gives you that peace that you find in your home. He blesses you with that. That comes from Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That doesn't just come because you're accustomed to going to your house. Because let's face it, for a lot of families out there, home is the last place they want to be. Home is where all the stress and the pain and the struggle comes from. So they do their best to be at work as late as possible, to be out as much as possible. So when you do find peace and tranquility, Allah says that's from Him. And then Allah continues, وَجَعَلَ لَكُم مِّن جُلُودِ الْأَنْعَامِ بُيُوتًا. Then we also made from the skins of these cattle, buyuta, homes as well. So the Arabs and the Mushrikun and the Quraysh during the time in desert life, this is how they build their homes, at least back then. They would use the skins of these animals, dry them, tan them, harden them, and use them to create their roofs and design clothing and other things as well. تَسْتَخِفُونَهَا يَوْمَ ظَعْنِكُمْ تَسْتَخِفُونَهَا. This particular word, تَسْتَخِفُونَهَا, means to weaken something. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues, and He says that the Quraysh, one of the things that they used to do, one of the methods that they used to do to keep their people under control to an extent, was to limit how far and how much they excel. And as a matter of fact, even Fir'aun used to do this. Fir'aun used to limit his slaves and his people so that they wouldn't excel. You know, if when we talk about systematic racism and when we talk about these subjects where certain minorities do their best to educate themselves, but then opportunities are missed or they don't get the same opportunities as others, all of this falls under this term, تَسْتَخِفُونَهَا. It's when a system is in place to keep people under control, and this is the maximum. This is the threshold. You don't go beyond that. You can be a manager, but you'll never be the CEO. That's what تَسْتَخِفُونَهَا is. And then Allah says, يَوْمَ ضَعْنِكُمْ. They would use these kinds of blessings even when they were traveling. Dharnikum is another word in the Quran for safar. Safar is the most common word for travel. The difference between the two is dharnikum is used that when you travel, you make multiple stops. So you go to this city, you go to that city. So it's very, it fits in perfectly with Bedouin life back then. You know, you're traveling on these animals, and you're going from place to place to place. Now, in context, تَسْتَخِفُونَهَا, to lighten the way, to minimize, this was referring specifically to the Bedouins. When they had their camels and they were traveling to different places, they had to limit how much weight they would put on the camel. It's just like you and I when we're going on long distance traveling and we're driving to long distances. We make sure that we limit the amount of weight that we put on our cars because why? The heavier the vehicle, the more gas it burns. So it's the same idea with animals. The heavier and the more burden you put on these animals, the weaker they become. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that that frame of mind, that knowledge, that common sense, call it what you like, that's from Allah as well. يَوْمَ ظَعْنِكُمْ, when you travel from place to place, وَيَوْمَ إِقَامَتِكُمْ, and even when you stop in these places, you also use these animals, وَمِنْ أَصْوَافِهَا, أَصْوَافِهَا from صُفُوف, from صُفُّن, which means wool. So you can take these animals and you can use their skin and use it for warmth. وَأَوْبَارِهَا, and أَوْبَارِهَا is the hairs or the fibers from animals like camels and goats and birds. So the hairs that come off of them are also used to create things. وَأَشْعَارِهَا, so that was very specific to animals. أَشْعَارِهَا from شَعْرٌ is also human hair as well. So it becomes more generic. So hair is mentioned, but in more generic form. أَثَاثَا, أَثَاثَا is furniture, but in old Arabic, it's all household items. So أَثَاثَا. So you're able to use these animals to even make all household items that are useful. وَمَتَاعًا إِلَى حِينٍ, and you can, you know, be satisfied and comfortable as long as you need to. Do you know what's happening here? This is why I title Surah An-Nahl, the surah that helps us to appreciate the little things in life. That's what Surah An-Nahl is all about. It's about the little things in life. We talked about bees, we talked about camels, we talked about goats and sheep and the skins that we use that are on them. We also talked about shades, we talked about birds, we talked about so many different things that are mentioned here. We talk about the sky, we talk about the earth, we talked about we talked about milk, we talked about leban, yogurt. We talked about all of these things that normally we wouldn't sit there and reflect on. That's what makes Surah An-Nahl so special. It helps us to appreciate the little things in life that most people, most of mankind, take for granted, don't really reflect on. Allah Azza wa Jal continues, وَاللَّهُ جَعْلَ لَكُم مِّمَّا خَلَقَ ظِلَالًا, Allah had placed for you, from what He created from you, shadows. You know, shadows can also be a lifesaver, especially when you're in the desert. The moment you find a shadow, that's it. You can survive for a bit. You can re-energize. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, even the shadow itself, whenever you find shadow from any object, that in and of itself is a shadow that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows to be there. وَجَعَلَ لَكُم مِّنَ الْجِبَالِ أَكْنَانًا, and Allah Azza wa Jal also created within the mountains caves, أَكْنَانًا, caves where you go and you shade yourself from the sun. وَجَعَلَ لَكُمْ سَرَابِيلَ تَقِيكُمُ الْحَرُ, and we also placed for you سَرَابِيل. سَرَابِيل literally means pants, but again, in old Arabic, it means clothing in general. So pants, shirts, and everything else. It's amazing because Allah is saying the fact that you have clothing, oh, by the way, that clothing is from me. سَرَابِيل also refers to clothing that's tailored to you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, despite that you might go to a tailor, get a shirt done or a pants or what have you, Allah is the real tailor. Allah is the one that designed that clothing for you. The little things in life, subhanAllah, brothers and sisters, that's what we're learning, that's what we're being encouraged and reminded in this surah. It's the little things in life. تَقِيكُمُ الْحَرُ وَسَرَابِيلَ تَقِيكُمْ بَأْسَكُمْ. And also clothing that is used in the most difficult of times. So meaning in battle, you also create armor that you can protect yourself. That armor is also designed, structured, and molded from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. كَذَلِكَ يُتِمُّ نِعْمَتُهُ عَلَيْكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُسْلِمُونَ. This is how Allah completes His noble favors on you so that you can submit yourself to Him. How many people do that? How many people say, you know, Alhamdulillah, I have clothing to wear, so I'm going to just worship you, O Allah. Thank you for clothing. You know, that's why we have a dua for getting dressed. You know, we look in the mirror and we pray to Allah that, you know, may Allah Azza wa Jal bless us that I'm able to wear this clothing. And one of the du'as is that you ask Allah to beautify you with your clothing. So that's why those du'as are there. It's so that you can make that connection from the trivial things and how little things in life connect you back to your Creator. يَعْرِفُونَ فَإِن تَوَلَّوا فَإِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينُ. If you reject this, then indeed all you can do is give and present the clear message. So at the end of the day, for prophets and messengers, the only thing that you can do is, at least at the end of the day, project this message. So even if the people reject this, it gives you an idea in context. The Mushrikun and the Quraysh, they are in no comparison to any other generation. Just keep in mind, like the Kuffar, the non-Muslims of today, you can't compare them to the Quraysh. The Quraysh them and the Mushrikun, they were the worst of the worst. They, at the end of the day, even though they knew and they realized their blessings that they had with Allah, intentionally rejected it. So that this way, this is what Allah tells His Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. He's like, look, at the end of the day, if this until now they rejected, then it's done. All you can do is just tell it them and leave them. Just move on. There's just no hope after this. So many prophets and messengers and pious men and women came of the past, generations over generations. Now you are the last and final prophet. If you can get through to them, that's it. There's nothing else that can be done. وَمَا عَلَيْكَ إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينُ. Last ayah. يَعْرِفُونَ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ. They know fully well the blessings from Allah. ثُمَّ يُنْكِرُونَهَا. But intentionally they rejected it. وَأَكْثَرُهُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. And most of them had disbelieved. So, I hope that now you're starting to piece the surah together. And I've said it over and over. The little things. So often Muslims focus on all the major problems and the major things in life. They use dua for the big problems. But Aisha radiallahu anha once said, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning make dua to Allah even if it's for a shoelace. Make dua to Allah that you at least have a shoelace. So the little things in life are just as important. It's one of the mistakes that people make with dua is they restrict it to not when I have a headache, but if I get cancer or I have a tumor. Not when I hurt myself, but if I'm in a car accident. You know, not if, you know, my child misbehaves, but only when they run away from me. That's not what dua is restricted to. It's not just the big things, even the little things in life. And appreciation as well. Not when you give birth to the child and alhamdulillah, you have your first child, you say alhamdulillah. But the fact that, you know, you got married, the fact that you're able to get pregnant, and the fact that you're able to go through the pregnancy healthy, with strength, alhamdulillah, for all of that. Even before you birth that child. Just the little things. That's what the surah is teaching us. And you know what's remarkable? Allah called the surah after one of the tiniest creatures on the face of this planet. But the bee is the only insect that I can think of that human beings depend on the most. I can't think of another insect that we depend on more than the bee. You know, we get medicine, we get all these wonderful things from the bee. And even aside from the honey, the whole process of pollination, you know, our flowers can grow and bloom, and our vegetables can grow, our foods can be, you know, harvested. And all of this comes back and is connected to this incredible creature. So Allah named this surah after one of the tiniest creatures on the planet, but one that we depend on, subhanAllah, so much. So this is the core lesson of Surah An-Nahl. Tomorrow, inshallah, we'll take another section, and oh my goodness, we're really coming to the end of the surah, guys. So let's start thinking about some of the things that we want to study afterwards, inshallah. I have some ideas, but I'll share that with you as we get to the end. May Allah Azza wa Jal continue to teach us this beautiful deen, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of you, keep you safe and healthy wherever you are. Allahumma ameen. Jazakum Allahu khairan. Until tomorrow, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.